It's time for Talkin Tauntauns! Your Star Wars source at AIPTComics.com.
Welcome back to another episode of Talkin Tauntauns. I am your host this week, Jim Lehane, and hopefully I won't derail this train as quickly as I did last time. And with me, as always, is Nicole Herview. And with us is not JJ. He had to tap out. And in process of tapping out, he tagged in the person who will probably derail this train faster than possible. And that is our old friend, Connor Christiansen.
Back from the dead. Yeah, I am absolutely going to derail this episode. I can't wait. I'm actually really looking forward to it. JJ texted me this morning. He was like, hey, do you think you could fill in for me tonight? I'll send you the agenda. I said, don't you dare send me the agenda. I'm going in blind. Is this still a Star Wars podcast, or have we switched to like an ecology biology podcast yet?
Game of Thrones, actually.
Yeah.
Good.
I hear the last season is great.
Like, that's what I was hoping we would talk about, because I have a lot of thoughts and they're all positive.
Well, you know what? This is the episode where live on recording, I kill you and stuff you in a tauntaun as I rightfully need to.
I knew this was going to happen.
So this was a trick.
I've prepared my battle axe. I have stretched enough and we can do battle.
Okay.
I'm glad we filled out that contract.
We need 500 subscribers on the Patreon, and then you get to watch it.
Correct. Then I'll film it.
Available only to the $10 tier.
Lord.
I don't even have the $10 tier.
You're looking at a $5 Patreon member here. That's right. Left the show, kept subscribing to Patreon. Patreon.
Patreon. You got Patreon. It. Good boy.
Has extra letters in there, I think. I think there's an O.
There is an O.
Yeah.
In both Patreon and Patreon.
There's an extra E in Patreon versus patron.
Yeah.
All right.
So anyway.
I'm glad we had that discussion.
I'm glad I write for a living, guys, so I can bring that kind of knowledge to everybody.
It's wonderful we got the derailment out of the way early. Yeah.
How are you doing, Nicole?
Oh, good. I'm hanging out, ready to talk some Bad Batch and my growing love for Hunter. I don't think there's an end to it. I think it's never gonna peak. I think it's just gonna keep going up. Goodbye.
I like Wrecker.
Wrecker's great too.
I mean, my thoughts on Omega haven't changed whatsoever. In fact, we get to talk about an episode where I got real hot and heated about something happening
she's
to
like
a beloved
she's
character.
She's like 12. That's not. Not
sir, this is a family show. Okay, it was in a very parental matter that I got upset.
Oh, okay.
All right, because it's not parental how I feel about Hunter.
I would like him to make me a parent.
I'd have that man's little clone babies. God help.
All right,
I'm done. Good night.
And on that note, I'm dialing JJ in as we speak.
Yeah, right. You get to deal with the two of us. It's like, it's really going to be upsetting for everybody.
All right. And I think on that note, we talk about some news. There's some things on the wire that got announced this past week.
Your tauntaun will freeze before you reach the first marker. Then I'll see you in hell.
Hello, what have we here?
So over the weekend, we had Comic-Con at home, which was an exciting event filled with you staring at your computer for more months on end. And I was actually part of that. My Science of Star Wars Comic-Con panel aired on Sunday afternoon. Similar to stuff I talked about on the Scientology podcast, as well as on our podcast, which was Connor's last podcast. And we had a great round table. That was a lot of fun. You could see it on YouTube, I believe, now. If you missed the live recording, I tweeted out a bunch of the links on my personal Twitter. So you can find it there. But also, Star Wars related, Wave 3 of Phase 1, which is the final wave of Phase 1, of the High Republic was announced.
a lot of waves and phases and numbers and nonsense. But yes, third release.
Part one, subsect three, books four, five, and six. I think it's the specific breakdown.
Correct.
Well, it's book three, 3.1, and 3.2.
Yeah. Weird. Yeah. Well, because, I mean, what would you consider is Into the Dark? Is that, I guess that's not technically the sequel to Light of the Jedi.
No, it's the, it takes place at the same time as, or, yeah, Into the Dark. That was Claudia Gray's first one. So, yeah, it's a, they're all part of that first wave of phase one. So that would be like book 1.2.
And then wave two, we have the next book in wave two comes out tomorrow, or at least the day of this recording tomorrow, which would be the 27th. The lovely Justina Ireland, who you guys just interviewed.
Yes.
Her book comes out
to, Out of the Dark, I think.
Out of the Dark. Into the Dark, Out of the Shadows.
Out of the Shadows.
Out of there we go. We know Star Wars. So
I can make a Star Wars name. Just give me a couple words, and it'll be like one of those poetry magnets. I'll just
You just need verb, determiner, and then noun. That's it. Out of the Shadows. Boom. Boom.
Rise of the Shadows.
There, yeah.
Rise of the Dawn of the Death of the Planet of the Apes.
Yeah.
Yes. Shadows of the Sith. There.
Shadow of Mordor. There. I'm gonna pull in every other fandom. Here I go.
I don't think Mordor's in this one.
Nope,
Wrath,
in this one.
Wrath of Khan.
Wrath
of Khan.
I don't think any of those are Star Wars.
not yet. They aren't. I'm very excited. I did not watch this panel because I haven't finished The Rising Storm yet, and I didn't want to potentially have anything spoiled. However, I found out on Twitter later that they don't talk about details of the book at all, so I can finally watch the panel.
Knowing that I recorded my Star Wars panel over Memorial Day weekend, there's no knowing when they actually recorded this. This could have been recorded, like, months ago.
It's a good point. I didn't think of that. But, no, I think for me personally, I don't know about your guys' thoughts, because I know we haven't done a hired public check-in in a while. Other than the talking about the I know you guys talked about the comics a few weeks ago, but for me, still, there's nothing in the High Republic that has really missed for me. I've enjoyed all of it. And that includes like the young adult novels. I know like, Into the Dark that one's a young adult, but the middle grade books too. Justina Ireland's other one, I can't remember, A Test of Courage. I thoroughly enjoyed that. That book was weirdly like, grief stricken. Like that whole book was a full blown kids book about how do you get over death? Like, whoa, wait, what? Like, so I think, I don't know. I'm very, very excited for more High Republic books. I keep forgetting that this is supposed to take like 5 years or so, right? Like they have like publishing plans for a while.
It's going to be a minute. Yeah.
So I'm excited, and I like what I'm about halfway through The Rising Storm so far. A little bit over halfway, and I'm really happy with the way it's building up and the story it's building towards and what it's doing for the initiative moving forward. So all good stuff. I keep trying to get like book readers into it. I'm like if you want to, because I've heard a lot of people complain, like, oh, I want to read the Star Wars books, but there's just so many, I don't know where to start. I keep trying to push them, like, just do the High Republic, like, get in on the first book. Don't even read all of them. Just read the main books, and you'll love it.
Yeah. I've liked everything. Mostly everything I've read. We talked about some stuff, you know, in other episodes. But yeah, I'm a big fan of everything. And I think the thing I'm most excited about, I can't keep track of my screens, apparently, but Edge of Balance, I'm really, really excited about and absolutely can't wait to get my hands on. So I think that's kind of what I'm most excited for. In this next launch, I guess. And
Edge of Balance comes out before this next launch.
Does it? I'm skimming right now.
It's like comes out in September. I think
because it's in this roundup.
When we talked to Justina, I believe she is the co-writer.
She's a co-writer. Yep.
She's the, I think, as she put it, like, basically the translator to make sure it fit into the High Republic translator, not even like the English translator.
No. Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, I'm excited for that. So that's fun.
I'm super excited for that one. I love manga and just more Japanese flair into the storylines.
That book will be my my first ever manga.
So wow.
Welcome. Very much looking forward to it. Pre-ordered it back in January when it was supposed to come out in April, I think. Because maybe this was supposed to be a part of Wave 1. It was supposed to be a part of one of the earlier waves and it got delayed till this fall. But either way, I'm very excited for it. I love that they're giving, we're getting another comic book series in Wave 3. And it's Charles Sewell doing it. I'm very much looking forward to hearing who they're going to pair him up with art-wise. But, I mean, Charles Sewell has done such a wonderful job with Star Wars comics as a whole, but particularly when he does Star Wars miniseries, I think that's where his work is the strongest. Looking at, like, his Lando series is fantastic. Rise of Kylo Ren is great. War of the Bounty Hunters so far. I listened to your guys' episode about it, so I know your thoughts. I am, for the most part, enjoying it with a couple complaints here or there. So I'm really happy he's getting another comic. And then our boy Daniel Jose Older is getting a young adult book. So I'm very excited about that as well.
Yeah, I'm amped to see Claudia Gray do the main, the adult novel.
That's what I was about to say, too. She's great. Super stoked.
Yeah. So in order, Claudia, like you said, Claudia Gray is doing the adult novel called The Fallen Star. And overall, their title on this thing says The Light of the Jedi Goes Dark. So sounds ominous.
Sounds evil. Very exciting.
Yeah. Mission to Disaster by Justina Ireland is the middle grade. And then the young adult, like you said, is our buddy DJO. I don't know if I can call him that. I didn't call him that to his face, so we'll just go with that. is Midnight Horizon, and then Eye of the Storm is Charles Sewell, the Marvel line.
Yeah, so a lot of good stuff.
Lots of good stuff.
Like I said, with the way the Rising Storm is going, I'm not surprised that it's called The Light of the Jedi Goes Dark, because it's like, yeah, you're sort of building towards that, so it makes sense. It's just, I keep thinking, I'm like, man, if this is the final wave of Phase 1. Like, I can't wait to see where this goes, because it already feels like it's going to culminate in this big, huge thing. Just, you know, really excited about it all.
Yeah, I think it's cool to see, like, you know, the pitch, I think, in the beginning with the High Republic was like, okay, let's go see the Jedi in their heyday. Like, let's do that. Like, awesome. Cool. Love that. But then to see, like, The Light of the Jedi Goes Dark. I'm like, of course there were going to be issues. Like, of course we weren't just going to see them running around and having a great time and dealing with space trash. Like, that wasn't going to be it. Like, there had to be some horrible thing. And I don't know if it's the Nile or if it's something else. Like, but I'm excited.
Maybe they're in denial.
Maybe they're in denial. Wow, that was great.
Boo.
I loved it, actually.
I did not miss that.
And Connor got disconnected somehow, and we'll miss him.
Bye, Connor. I'm going back to the dead. Yeah.
Notable absence from that author list is Kevin Scott, who I have not started The Rising Storm yet. I just finished Alphabet Squadron 3, which took me probably the better part of 16 years to get through. But he is coming out with the next audiobook, Tempest Runner, which focuses on, I forget her name.
Sandra
Lorna D. Lorna D.
Sandra D's cousin, twice removed, yeah.
And I think that was also coming out before the next wave. I'm just ignoring him.
Me too.
hate you guys. JJ would have liked that joke. No, he wouldn't have. Let's be honest.
No, he wouldn't have.
No, I just got a text message from JJ, and he says no, he wouldn't have.
I'm listening in, and I hated that.
He's secretly in this call.
But yeah, I think you're right, Jim. I don't think that it's the Tempest Runner, right? Is what it's called.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Just Tempest Runner.
I don't think it's a part of Wave 3.
I was reading this article wrong.
Yeah, like Wave 2.5, we'll call it.
Yeah, it's similar to Edge of Balanced, kind of fillers, which is good because we didn't have anything between Wave 1 and Wave 2 except for the comic series. And so this kind of, I like how they're slowly starting to spread it out instead of throwing three major books at you at once. Like,
well, yeah.
I can't read.
I'm a very slow reader.
Like, me too.
I think The Rising Storm is 420 pages. I mean, we're looking at legit a month. Like, we have our book club next Saturday. Uh-huh. I gotta like sprint read the next 2 weeks to get through. I mean, granted, I'm kind of lucky. I'm like halfway through, but it's like, oh yeah, I gotta like bear down and read, which is fine because I'm really really liking it. But like, so I'm glad that they're spacing it out more. Because I should finish this just in time to dive into Out of the Dark or Out of the Shadows.
Yeah, into Neverland.
Into Neverland. Got it. Yep. Yeah, same. I like to take my time with a book. Like, that's just my vibe. And yeah, I'm about, I want to say a quarter into the last one. And I'm like, why do I have no time to read anything but Star Wars books? I'm not complaining. But at the same time, it's like, I want to read other stuff too. Like, I just... You know, there's a list as long as my arm of novels and stuff I want to read that are coming out. And, you know, I'm like, let's mix it up a little bit. So as much as I love and eat, sleep, and breathe Star Wars, I need a snack at something else once in a while, my guys.
I am in the exact same predicament. I try to always do Star Wars book, non-Star Wars book, mm-hmm. Star Wars book, non-Star Wars book. But the way it's gone recently is, like, every time I finish a Star Wars book, a new one comes out that I'm like, well, I want to read this right away. And then another one comes. Like, I still have Skywalker Family at War, Lost Stars, the first Alphabet Squadron book, and Master and Apprentice all sitting in front of me. And then behind me on my bookshelf, I want to read Stephen King's The Stand. I have Dune, which JJ laughed in my face when I told him I bought it to read. He was like,
yeah, good luck with that.
He was like, good luck.
Truly good luck.
I like Dune.
I mean, Dune's supposed to be friggin' phenomenal, but it's a mountain. It's a mountain to climb.
He told me it's super, super dense and will take forever. Yes. So, oh, and then I also have Daniel Jose Older's, his book, Race to Crash Point Mountain. Crash Point Tower. So, I you guys can't see the stacks of comics around me because I cleaned up a little bit. I'm 3 weeks behind on my comic book reading, with the exception of Star Wars books are the only ones that I'm reading as they come out. So I feel it. I feel the pain of having a large stack to read, but I believe it was the almighty and wise Charles Sewell who once tweeted, a stack of unread books is nothing but adventures promised.
Ooh, so, love that. Appreciate that.
Don't feel bad about your unread books, people. And that's my time. That's been Connor with a little bit of wisdom.
My lord. Yeah, I've had the Black Spire book for like a year, like sitting on my desk and like, oh, I got to read that before I go to Galaxy's Edge.
Definitely.
Going in 2 months and I don't know when I'm going to read it. So I'm like, okay, everyone's got to shut up for a minute and I got to read this book. Lord above. Anyway. And then there's other books as well. But not
for anyone who is part of the book, the Patreon for AIPT, we are doing, I don't know if JJ ever announced it, we are doing our next book club is The Rising Storm for next Saturday the 7th. I still haven't even started it yet, so good luck with that. But I do audiobooks, so I can pound through that while mowing my my lawn, which takes forever.
You're a smart man.
It's very short chapters for the most part, so it is like it kind of moves along pretty quickly.
Good.
Not as much as, I will give you a warning, Jim, not as breakneck as a start as Light of the Jedi.
Okay. So, well, I've heard nothing but good things about it.
It's
good. It's enjoyable.
I am thoroughly enjoying it so far. It's good. I'll say it's very good. I don't want to get. We'll get into it during the book discussion. I'm sorry.
There you go. Join the Patreon. Join our book club, and then you'll hear what we have to say about it. There you go.
Yeah, and remember, 500 subscribers, and Nicole and I fight to the death.
Correct.
Also, actually coming out this week, the DK, I believe, sent me. I can't find my copy. It was right here. A copy of Star Wars Mazes, and it's one of those like. you think of it's kind of a stupid little maze book, but some of these mazes are absolutely amazing.
They're amazing?
They're amazing. I didn't do that on purpose.
Well, I liked it anyway.
But they're hard. Like, my daughter and I would sit there for, like, we sat there for 20 minutes trying to figure out, like, some of these mazes. And they are intricate details, like, to the max. And I highly recommend if you have kids or you just kind of like to play these stupid games, that I recommend you go out and get it. The art is really, really good on it.
Oh, my God. I'm looking at them now, some of these mazes. These look so frustrating.
They're
so intricate.
Go on, Jim.
Oh, they are super intricate, but like, they're built into like the Star Wars world, and so it's not just a maze. It is actually like the planet Tatooine. You're trying to get through the different buildings or get through the Death Star, going over bridges and under bridges and stuff. And it's actually quite a bit of fun just to kind of sit there and marvel at the artwork and kind of work your way through the book. So that is so cool. They're so fun looking.
These are the first mazes I think I've ever seen where there's multiple levels. There's stairs.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. There's stairs. There's bridges. As long as you do it right, like you do go under the bridge like you're supposed to. So it's they're ones that I will frequently start at the end and start at the beginning and try to find the middle.
I'm the girl who starts at the end and then tries to get like work it backwards. It never works, but I try. And then I'm like, why don't I just do it like a normal person? And I'm like, because I have to do everything the hard way. But anyway, yeah, that looks awesome. And I might have to invest in this. This is so cool.
So, and my last piece of news, my 6-inch Jackson action figure came. It kind of looks like they molded his face with mashed potatoes and then stepped on it.
Cool. Yeah.
Like, they tried to make him look realistic, which doesn't work for the character.
You mean it's hard to make a life-size human rabbit man with blasters look real?
Well, like, look at the comic.
Yep, like, that's Bunny Man.
Yeah, and then look.
Aww. Yeah. It's Bunny Man. It's sort of nightmare fuel.
I'm scared of that.
It's rough. I've heard similar things from other people. I was talking to a guy and he's like, yeah, I saw it in the GameStop. I picked it up and I immediately put it back down.
Yeah, no from me, dog.
And I don't necessarily think that's like a detriment to the Black Series line or like Hasbro or anything. It's just, that's just a really hard character to make not terrible.
Yeah. Well,
it's like if you made him cartoony, that's what he's supposed to be, but the Black Series line is supposed to be realistic, and so you'd be going against what the grain of the line is. So
yeah.
I can understand what they were doing. They didn't do it, but I can understand it.
I mean you're kind of stuck in a hole, and especially just like, I don't know if it would be as creepy if I hadn't just like looked up the entire story of like the Bunny Man, like the, you know, the like weird murderer guy, the Bunny Man dressed up as a bunny, killed some people, urban legend stuff.
I could see Connor Googling it right this second.
If you've ever seen, and I can't necessarily recommend it, but I'm gonna recommend it, there's a found footage movie called The Houses October Built, and it's fine. Like, as far as found footage movies, horror movies go. But they put, like, the Bunny Man in that. Like, there's one character who I'm like, oh, it's the Bunny Man. He's got an axe. Isn't that great? Yeah, Bunny Man's horrifying. And I think that's probably why that scares me so much. Oh.
I thought you were going to go with Harvey.
Harvey?
The Bunny Man.
I don't know the Bunny Man named Harvey.
Harvey is a story about a life-sized talking rabbit that the main character is the only person who can see because he's invisible, basically a figment of his imagination.
Is it Donnie Darko?
No.
Gone.
Jim, this movie, and why would we know this?
Let me look this up. What did you
I
say,
actually,
Harvey?
When I was in Harvey, when I was in high school, I was part of the stage crew that did the set of Harvey. So I'm well
Harvey
acquainted
the Bunny.
With it.
This movie
Harvey.
Is 71 years old.
Oh, it's from 1950. Yes, it's 71 years old. That'll do it.
Thank you for the math.
Oh, my Lanta. No. When I say absolutely not, nope. That's terrifying.
Next, Jim's going to drop a Mr. Smith Goes to Washington reference.
There you go.
Or a 12 Angry Men. That's right. I know old movies, too.
Actually, I've never seen either of those. They're on my list of movies to see, though.
Actually, honestly, Mr. Smith Goes to Washington is a fantastic film.
Oh, I want to see it. Yeah. And on that note, let's talk some Bad Batch.
Let's do it.
So why haven't I heard of this squad? Experimental Unit Clone Force 99. The defective clones with desirable mutations. They call themselves the Bad Batch.
All right. We, since the... We're in the second half of the season now. 8 episodes total in the second half. And so we're only going to talk the first 4 of that second half. So the third 4 of the season, episode 13 did just air over the weekend, but neither Nicole or I have had time to actually watch it. And so we are just going to do episodes 9 through 12. And kicking off this first half is episode 9, Bounty Lost. And I basically summarized this down to Fennec Shand versus Cad Bane. So Cad Bane had gotten Omega at the end of episode 8, where we first see our guest star of the episode, and takes her back to, I'm going to say, Kamino? Like, did we ever get a confirmation that was Kamino?
I don't know if they got all the way back to Kamino. I think he stopped somewhere, and I don't remember where it is.
It had big Bespin vibes.
It did, right?
But I don't think it was Bespin.
Neither do I.
But it felt it did feel a lot like Bespin.
Like, it's because Cad Bane's talking to one of the Kaminoans, and I guess, wasn't it the Prime Minister? It's been quite a few weeks since I've seen this one. And he is supposed to drop off Omega, because we find out in this episode who Omega really is, which is probably the biggest reveal of the entire series so far, is that she is a Prime clone of Django. She's essentially,
I got feelings about that.
Yeah, she's basically Boba's sister.
Basically, yeah. I mean, I've said in the past what I thought they were going to do with her and why I thought she was going to be, like, important and needed, and this is not that. And I'm fine with being wrong. That's not the issue. I don't care. I just feel like this, if what you do is more interesting than what I think you're about to do, then great, no problem. This isn't more interesting to me. And it's also maybe a little bit mildly problematic for some reasons that I don't know if we want to get into right now.
We're talking the first episode. This is where all the information dropped.
This I'm not going to say I picked up on this right away, because I didn't, but it was a really good point I saw in a review on Den of Geek. I did not get the writer's name because I'm a horrible person, but if you look at the episode review on Den of Geek, you'll see the full commentary. But it was basically, there's already some questions about, you know, you have like a darker skinned man who is the prototype, the like origin of all of these clones, who seem to have lighter skin than him, which is interesting. And then you've got Omega, who is the fairest little clone I've ever seen in my life. And she is the, like,
she's the fairest of them all.
She's something. And it's like, she's so valuable and all this stuff. And it's like, it's just, you keep whitewashing Jango Fett. Like, you just keep doing it. They just keep doing it. And I was like, that is a pretty darn good point. and something that I didn't pick up on right away, but I was, something about it was bothering me. And then I read that and I was like, okay, you have my attention.
That's a point I had brought up when we were talking about the first half of the season, is right. that it's a major contention online where,
yeah.
I'm forgetting his name, the actor.
Temuera Morrison.
Yeah, Temuera Morrison. He's a Maori individual. Right. And so you have, you're right, a darker skinned individual be basically portrayed with a lot of whiter skinned people, which you can attribute to the cloning process, and they're all like defects, but you can't get away from the fact that like this is what the outcome is. And then you have this prime example of Omega. But it's an interesting take. Also, she's older than all of them.
Right. That's the other thing is like, wouldn't she be older than all of them? She's like a first gen clone.
If she's a first gen clone of Django, theoretically the same age as Boba, which would make her 14 at this time.
Sure.
Ish. 13, she'd be about 13. And
they make her age very vague.
Yeah, it is vague. Yeah, I remember that they like when they first introduced Boba in the prequels, Django had said something to the effect of like this was a clone that didn't have the like rapid aging situation because he wanted a son, right?
Yes.
He wanted to have one for himself.
Unaltered clone. I think how he put it.
So why Omega as well? Like, was it just so they had another one lying around, or what? My question is why. That's my furthering. Like, why is that so important?
I think what DNA.
I answered my own question.
Yeah, I think they just alluded to like, or the way I read into it was like, we just wanted to see if we could make a girl, and we did.
Well, it's not all that difficult. Genetics wise, you just turn off the Y chromosome and you basically have a female version with the same DNA.
Well, they had said in this episode, like, she's the exact genetic footprint. I was like,
but she's not.
minus like, you know, that one chromosome. So not an exact genetic copy.
Right. Which is why, like, you can't have identical twins of differing, you know, sexes.
Yeah.
Right? So, like, it's interesting that they would be like, she's an exact replica. And it's, like, literally the definition of not exact. Like, fascinating.
I suppose
she's also whiter.
And also whiter. Like,
looks really nothing like him.
Yeah, and, nothing. Like, listen, I'm not the person who can do a full commentary on that kind of thing, so I'm not going to even try. But I do think that it's worth listening to people who are. Because it doesn't sit right with me, and I'm a white lady. So that means there's something there, and that we should be considering and looking into. And that's why that decision doesn't really sit right with me. Besides the logic of it all, you know, that she's clearly not an exact replica. But yeah, it's that one. I didn't love that choice. And that's I'll leave that.
I thought they played it off as like in the moment of the episode, they like made it like this huge reveal, like made it feel like it was this huge thing, like you'll never see this coming. I was like, oh, I thought we just assumed already that she was another she's a Boba Fett clone, duh. Like, I was not all that surprised, so for me it was like it was a weird moment in the episode where they're like, huge reveal, and I'm like, yeah, what, didn't we already agree on this?
One of my biggest problems with all of that was in the episode 12 when I think she's talking to Hera, and Hera's something like, why do you like these guys? And she's like, well, they're my brothers. Like a callback to Return of the Jedi. It's like, you just found out they were your brothers like three episodes and like 10 minutes ago. Like,
that's keeping in line with Star Wars. You fall in love very quickly and sometimes irrationally. That's a trope of the franchise, baby.
It felt to me like she was looking for a word to call them the whole time, like a reason why she was so connected to them, found it, and now just latched onto it, which is something kids do. So that didn't bother me a lot, but, like, I get it. It's like, my friend, you just we just learned this. But also, like, weren't we assuming it? But yeah,
they're my uncle dads.
They're my uncle dad's sons.
I think those are my stepdads, but I'm not 100% sure.
Those are my stepdads, but also my children, but also my brothers. And I really don't know.
It's like the show My Two Dads. We don't really know who the dad is, but we're going to both raise the child. That is bringing it back. Both the show, neither of you have probably ever watched.
No, but I've heard of it. I mean, it sounds fun for the whole family.
one thing on this episode that I did really, really like, the fight between Fennec Shand and Cad Bane was awesome.
Yeah, like, yeah.
Going around
I wrote in my notes, how does Cad Bane keep living? That's the note. Like, how? But yes, it was an awesome fight.
I think it's an interesting take, because you have Cad Bane, who's the notorious bounty hunter, essentially, at this point, and he has a lot of history, so he knows kind of how to handle himself. And you have Fennec Shand, who they don't want to diminish at all. They don't want to make her less than they were, or less than she is. And so they can't have Cad Bane beat her, like, to a pulp outright, but they can't have her beat Cad Bane, who has more experience than her. And so it's like a balancing act. Like, how do you solve this? And basically it's to let Omega get away and not actually have a conclusive finishing to the fight.
Yeah, for sure.
I think there, when it comes to having Fennec Shand, it's cool to see, we all know, like, nobody loves to play with their own toys more than Dave Filoni. Like, he does it in every show.
It's his Filoniverse.
Exactly.
I am full on board with using that term now.
Yeah, he's less concerned about Star Wars as a whole and more concerned about my characters. Which, don't get me wrong, I have no problem with that. His characters are wonderful, and he adds a ton to Star Wars with his characters. Sure, I'm going to stand by it. I said what I said.
He adds a lot to the lore.
Yes, that's what I was trying to say.
With his additions to the lore.
Yes. He deepens the lore by adding depth to it.
Correct.
By using his 10 characters and constantly shuffling them like a deck of cards.
Listen.
But they're 10 really good characters.
I'm not going to complain about it, man. I enjoy it. He's playing with his toy box. I'm not mad.
But this is another example similar to the first episode with his whole canon contradiction thing. You run into a little bit of a problem here because, like you just, you know, laid out for us, Jim, is like, well, like, you've already established Cad Bane as the most, like, one of the most feared bounty hunters. But also we know that Fennec Shand also grows into one of the most feared bounty hunters, too. So how do you have that? And I think a way you could have done it in story to make it work is, well, this is Fennec Shand just as she's getting started out. She at some point she's gonna get humbled.
Correct.
Like, and I feel like the optics wouldn't have been good of having, like, let's have this established male character absolutely demolish this female character. Like, wouldn't be good optics. But in terms of character progression, it's like, well, she's gonna eventually have to, like, that's gonna probably happen. And I think this would have been a good opportunity to do that. And regardless, the fight was still great, but that would have been a better way to have a better conclusion other than simply, like, Omega ran away and outsmarted both of them. So
yeah, I feel like there's an opportunity to show a growth moment for her.
Exactly.
And yeah, and they just, like, it could have been really interesting to have him, you know, not beat the living hell out of her. Maybe it's a close fight, but he edges her out.
Then
now she's on a freaking mission. Now it's personal, and now she's gotta kill Cad Bane, and I'd really like to watch someone do that. So I don't know,
I like Cad Bane's voice, he can sit next to me and read me bedtime stories. That'd be fantastic. Also,
that
Connor,
weird Clint Eastwood thing, but a horrible human.
But
being.
Yeah,
but
and not talking
funny.
To an empty
I'm talking
chair.
About Cad Bane. Cad Bane. I'm like, he's nothing compared to Clint.
Why is Cad Bane talking to a chair? And that's a side note. Connor did find the name of the planet, Boravio, which I don't remember that ever being named.
I don't think it was. I only found it on Wikipedia. It was very Bespin. It was Bespin Light. I think, if I had to guess, I bet behind the scenes they're like, we want to take him to Bespin. And they were like, no. And they're like, well, we already rendered it. And they're like, Well, that's fine. Just make the station look decrepit and we'll call it something different.
Something with a B as well.
Yeah.
It's Besper?
Can we do that? Best boy.
No, they'll do they'll do the same thing they did with Dantooine and Tatooine. They'll call it Despin.
Mm. Yeah. Yes. They're on Dantooine. Really? You came up with that one all on your own now, didn't you?
It's like Alderaan and Onderaan. I'm like, yeah. You mean the same word? Like, I was so confused. Watching like the first episode on Onderaan, and I'm like, they're on Alderaan? They're on where? And then I put the subtitles on, and I was like, different place. Okay.
What the best part about that is that in some of the Clone Wars, they go to Moraban, which in Legends is called Korriban, but George Lucas didn't want people to get Korriban mixed up with Coruscant. And so Jay Filoni needed to change the name of Korriban, this well-established Sith planet, to Moraban, which is like one of those, like, pick your battles. Like, yeah, this doesn't seem like one that needed to be had.
Hey, people get really confused with phonetics, you know, yeah. Really throws them off.
All right. Any other thoughts on that episode? Because that's a big one. I think that...
That's a big one.
I just want more fights between Cad Bane and Fennec Shand. That was quality showdown.
I think Fennec, I can't imagine her not coming back, especially if they're going to try to pump up the Book of Boba Fett. She's one of the main stars of that.
You want to cement Fennec's rise to bounty hunter superstardom? Have her kill Cad Bane.
That's what I'm saying, man.
Yeah, I would. I think that would be an awesome ending to the Cad Bane story.
Well, she didn't kill him. It was the fall.
right.
No, I just shot her.
Yeah. So I wouldn't be surprised if she comes back within these last couple episodes that we haven't seen yet. All right. The next episode, episode 10, Common Ground. And this was one that I think all three of us went, what happened in that episode again?
Well,
it was like... Before the show started, we were talking about it, and I couldn't for the life of you. I was flipping through the episode. I couldn't for the life of you actually remember if I saw it. Basically, the Bad Batch gang is tasked by Sid to go rescue a separatist leader called there by his droid while Omega plays holochess.
Correct.
Yes.
And I think the description, I'm going to try to do it off the top of my head, but the description for the episode on Disney Plus was like the Bad Batch have to call into question like their belief system or something like that. And I'm like, but did they at all do that? Because I don't
Well, recall. Their belief system of leaving Omega out of the action?
Is that it? Is that what we're talking about? I don't know. It just seemed... I mean, I get... That, like, Echo deals with, like, the issue of, like, I don't want to rescue a separatist because they're the enemy. Like, I get it. I get that.
But you're like, now the enemy there, buddy.
It just wasn't really, I didn't feel that. I felt them just, like, doing a mission. You know what I mean?
I kind of, you get a little bit of them, because I guess Tech says to Echo, like, the war's over. They're, like, we don't really have enemies anymore. Like, right. We're kind of out for ourselves. And in a way, I think it a little bit speaks to the fact that, like, there really weren't, when you look at the Clone Wars, not the show, I mean, like, the Clone Wars as in the conflict, when you think about it, like, the, the Confederation of Independent Systems?
Yes.
We're simply declaring independence. That's, like, they're not inherently evil. And then you look at the Republic, and the Republic was trying to... So I think part of what that episode kind of got into was just, like, there really weren't ever any bad guys in the Clone Wars. Like, there was nobody inherently evil other than Palpatine pulling the strings from behind. And Dooku.
But yeah, even... More or less.
Yeah, but other than that, like, So I think that's kind of what they were trying to get at. They just didn't make it as clear as they could.
Yeah.
But I think overall, I still enjoyed it, the episode as a whole. Again, the action sequences in this show are phenomenal. But we were talking about before we started recording, the best part of this episode was Omega schooling people in holochess.
Like, she's a genius.
Yeah,
she's
that was
a little baby genius.
That was the most fun part.
It really was. And, like, I did enjoy seeing kind of, like, that line blur between like the clones and the stormtroopers. And you're like, aha. Like, I think a lot in this series, it's like moving a little bit more, like closer and closer towards stormtroopers. But like, this was the episode where I was like, aha, like there they all are. You know what I mean? Like, it's just, it keeps getting more and more clear that that's where this infantry is going, you know? Yeah.
I pulled up Disney Plus and you were totally on point with the description. It says the batch has their ideology challenged.
Hey, that's less words, so it's better. But yes, that's what I was getting at.
Yeah, I always prefer more words and less clarity. That's kind of my MO.
Ah, yes. Science.
Science.
You should be a lawyer, man. You'd be really good at it.
That's how I science.
That's like, how you science.
If you don't know what I'm talking about by the end of this conversation, then I have won.
Correct.
I don't have much to say on this. I don't really remember it that well, and it's it didn't leave much of an impression on me other than Omega schooling people on Holochess and then realizing that she shouldn't be left behind and Sid realizing that she knows how to take advantage of people.
Yep.
Yeah. The batch rescues Monopoly Man should have been the name of this episode.
Correct. I think the fact that we don't have a lot of recollection around it is commentary in and of itself.
Yeah. I will say, like, looking back on it, it's also, I mean, I haven't watched it since it aired, but I did enjoy the way it makes you kind of pause and think about, like, who really were the bad guys in the Clone War. And I just also like how it's kind of fleshing out more and more. Okay, how did the galaxy immediately react to the rise of the Empire? Because obviously we've seen a few years later in Rebels and Solo, but this is still like, we're talking like a couple weeks.
Yeah.
Like how did things immediately roll out? And I think it's interesting and entertaining to watch how like, oh yeah, they like immediately went into dictatorship and fascism and just everything awful. So I did enjoy that reason. This episode for that reason is it again? It added more to the, okay, how did the Empire go from Republic to Empire so quickly? And you're seeing like, oh, because they just did. They just immediately started occupying worlds and taking over local governments. And I think they're doing a good job of filling in those gaps.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the next two episodes, the last two that we're going to talk about, is really a two-part episode, and it's kind of there's a lot of thoughts that I have on these, and I know Nicole has on these. I don't know Connor's mindset on these two, but it's the Devil's Deal and Rescue on Ryloth. And it says, as the seeds of rebellion foment, that's a nice word, on an outer rim world, the Empire schemes to squash it. And then the Bask is tasked with a dangerous mission, because the batch is not mentioned in the description, and it's literally the only episode where the batch is not listed in the description. I just looked at every single one. It's the only one where the batch is not in the description title,
and that's because
I wouldn't even say they were in it. Like
They were in it for 2 seconds.
Yeah.
Fine. I don't necessarily mind that, but go on.
I texted Jim before the show this morning. We were talking about it. And then, like, I talked to my little brother and my dad about it. And I know Jim didn't necessarily agree with what I said to my little brother and my dad said. But three of us were just like, it's very enjoyable. It's great Hera backstory. Always love more Chopper in my life. Really good to see old characters again. Love it. I just like for my Bad Batch episodes to have the Bad Batch in them.
Are you gonna have dinosaurs on your dinosaur tour?
Yeah.
That's the question here.
Hold on, you gotta tap the screen with it. Are you gonna have dinosaurs on this
on your dinosaur tour?
It was excellent. A very, very good Rebels season zero episode. It's just didn't really want it in the middle of a Bad Batch. So it's like this weird thing, because it's like on its own, standing alone, very much enjoyed it. But it's like, oh, but like, I was really enjoying the way the Bad Batch was progressing, not this Rebels origin. Which, again, not like I'm fine with giving me more Rebels characters. I adore Rebels. It's arguably my favorite Star Wars content. But it's just like, maybe save that for another time. Or like, do a Rebels prequel series. Not completely derail the flow of the Bad Batch season to tell a Rebels prequel story.
Right, like, if that was interstitials, like, in another episode, like, if they had, like, kind of showed us what was going on over there while we were, like, with the Bad Batch for, like, a couple episodes, and then we got episode 12, I would have been maybe a little bit more receptive to it. But to watch all of this content, and for complete clarity, I haven't seen,
like,
Rebels yet.
That's what I was going to throw out. I'm like, you have not seen Rebels.
So I did say, I'm like, I know Hera Syndulla. I know that name. I know some of these words. Like, that was me. And then she said Chopper. And I was like, oh, everyone loves that son of a gun. Okay. I don't get it, but okay. Like, I just didn't get it from this episode. And, like, I get that that's, like, I know that when you probably watch this, you're bringing a lot to it. If you've seen Rebels, if you know these characters. I was just sitting there like, okay, okay. Like, when is this going to get interesting? Like, when am I going to care a little bit? And I really didn't until the next episode. And then I was like, okay, I'm invested. But, like, I don't know. Like, it was just paced really weird. And, like, the climax was not satisfying to me. I was watching it with my person, and it ended, and he looked at me and he was like, is that it? And I was like, that's it. That was the episode. And he was like, nothing happened. And I was like, nothing happened. And that's what we said to each other about it. And that was it. And I moved on with my life. Though I do like Hera a lot. Like, even with all of that, I love this character. I love her mom. I want that accent. It's probably because I'm French. But I'm like, that is, my God. It's like really cool, interesting characters. But I just felt like that was 5 minutes of plot in a 28-minute episode.
So
yeah,
my thoughts on all this.
Go, Jim.
This kind of blows up the issue that I've been having. I had the same problem with The Mandalorian Season 2. That I'm having with this show right now. And this episode kind of exemplifies it. It's become the Bad Batch comes in. Who's our special guest star of this episode? And almost every single episode of this season has had a special guest star that we have known from somewhere else. And it's like, oh, we have Tarkin in this episode. Oh, we have, I can't remember their name. The sisters. In this Martez. Episode, yeah, the Martez sisters, and we have this person or that person, and like every single episode has some sort of guest star, and this one had Hera, and I feel like a lot of them are put into the show because Filoni is playing with the Filoniverse. The same Mandalorian Season 2, literally every single episode had a special guest star, and it drives me nuts. I want to see the Bad Batch. You're giving me a show about the Bad Batch. I want to see the Bad Batch. I want to see them grow. I want to see them interact with Omega. I want to see them actually do something. They are not the focus of this first episode. They are barely in this first episode. And I came away with a sour taste in my mouth. And everybody I talked to online absolutely loved it. And as anybody who's listened to the show before, I love Rebels. Rebels is my favorite TV show. I love it way more than any of the other shows that have come out. But I didn't need it here. And I rewatched it. I rewatched it specifically today, this episode. I'm like, well, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm not seeing something. And nope, I just didn't like it. Like, I literally had to watch the ending about 5 times because I kept drifting off and I'm not paying attention.
Yeah, I think I do agree with you to an extent, Jim. I don't mind I don't mind the guest stars thing as a whole. So long as the guest stars aren't taking the focus away from the characters in the show. Like, The Mandalorian, for example, like, I loved bringing in Bo-Katan because it was still part of Mando's story and it was moving Mando's story forward. The Martez sisters and Tarkin popping up in The Bad Batch so far. It's like, cool, we're still moving The Bad Batch's story forward. I get frustrated with this episode in particular, even though, again, on its own, outside of the, call this Rebels Point Zero, I would have loved it. I would have no problem with it. But rather than it being a episode of The Bad Batch where Hera's in it, it felt like a Hera episode or a Hera show that The Bad Batch popped up in. And it didn't advance The Bad Batch's story at all. And that's where I get frustrated. It's like, okay, now you are letting the guest star or the guest appearance overshadow the main story. Even the Ahsoka Tano episode of The Mandalorian, even though I think that episode gets close to overshadowing the main overall plot, but it still doesn't completely take it over. So I think I do agree with you to an extent that, like, there are times where Filoni puts too much emphasis on the guest, like you said, the guest star of the episode, that he forgets, like, hey, this is not their show. And then to your point, Nicole, I think you're absolutely right. If anyone who hasn't seen Rebels, the importance of, like, I don't see how they'd enjoy that first episode, because it's like, well, yeah, it's all just Chopper and Hera fan service. So, yeah. Like, they handcuffed themselves with that one. There should have been a disclaimer beforehand, like, if you haven't seen Rebels, you can skip this.
It does do a nice connection between the Clone Wars episodes of Cham Syndulla and the Rebels kind of connect through, because Cham Syndulla comes back in Rebels as well. And so it's a nice little connecting skipping stone between them, but it's not a Bad Batch episode. And
exactly.
Like the rescue on Ryloth, the second episode refocuses it back on the Bad Batch, and it's already much more enjoyable by that.
I
liked this one a lot.
Yeah, love that episode. I can't remember the name of the clone. Are we moving on to that episode now?
Yeah, Hauser. Is that?
Yeah. My him doing the just like, now I'm not doing this anymore. It did make me question, like, hey, isn't he technically going against his neurological chip? Programming? But I wasn't. I was like, you know what?
Weird.
I don't.
The chips are weird.
Yeah, I let it go because I'm like, you know what? It's a good enough story beat that I'll suspend my belief anyway. Because I liked him standing up and asking other troopers, like, who's going to throw down their guns with me? I'm not doing this.
Maybe it's a sign that those inhibitor chips aren't always as effective as they think they are.
Yeah.
You know, that could be it.
Or they're just not turned on.
Like, that could be.
They turned it on for Order 66, because clearly they didn't know they even had it before Order 66. Turned it on for Order 66, and maybe, like, their effect is diminishing over time, or,
could
like,
be.
Something to...
It's working on Crosshair pretty damn well.
His to 11.
They did, yeah.
I thought for sure Crosshair was going to shoot him. Like,
I was
like, this is going to be heartbreaking when Crosshair shoots him.
Yeah, because it was such a good moment. And it was so, like, almost triumphant and, like, really cool. And I was like, before anyone joined him, I was like, Crosshair's just going to shoot him between the eyes. And he didn't. And I was shocked. I almost feel like that's a missed opportunity, because Crosshair is so angry. And I wrote, I don't know if I can say this, so I'm going to say it very much in isolation. I wrote down, Crosshair is a bitch. That was just my note.
I'll allow it.
Yeah. My goodness gracious. I know it's the inhibitor chip. I understand. I don't like him. And I know I'm not supposed to. He's so effective. He's so terrifying. He's great.
Speaking of shooting someone in the face,
yes.
Orn-Free Taw was apparently not murdered.
Nope.
Oh, yeah.
Attempted assassination.
Like,
I'm like, you shot him in the face.
Hey, like, you know, I suspend disbelief in, especially in the Star Wars cartoons, quite a lot. Because you'll see, like, a nobody stormtrooper takes a shot in the chest armor, immediately dies. But then Captain Rex, who has older armor, takes the same shot in the chest, and he's like, ah, I'm good. So
shake it off.
And I just go, because he's Rex, it's fine. This one was particularly egregious. It's like, Crosshair shot him in the face, and you're like, he's going to make a full recovery.
Yeah.
What?
Crosshair shot that guy in the mug.
Yeah.
Like, is Orn-Free Taw show up again in Rebels? Like, I don't remember him showing up.
I've read that he shows up in a book, in a canon novel, and is in there for a while. I don't remember the name of the book. But he's like a key player in this book that takes place after this moment. So they had to let him live.
It
had to be an attempted assassination.
Lords of
the
Sith.
Neck. Yes, there you go.
Yeah, Lords of the Sith does take place after this, because Cham, I believe, is also a big part of that book.
Yeah, then you definitely should have.
You shoot him somewhere else.
Not shoot him in the face.
Yeah.
Which also, It is still a kid's show, so it would have been a double win. A, it's more believable, and B, you don't show a bunch of children a man being shot in the face.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which also, speaking of, for a children's show, I mean, this show does rack up a bit of a body count.
It really does.
Like, it's kind of like, it's, I'm not complaining, but I could understand, like, if you're like a conservative Christian family and you're watching this, you're probably like, oh, there's so much blood and violence. They're shooting people in the mouth. It's kind of, it's
above the eye, I think. I think it was above the
eye. I think it was right from the temple, yeah.
It's right here. I'm pointing on the podcast, so you can see right here.
And, yes, everyone can see that.
And Twi'leks have very, very bulbous eyebrows that are hard to penetrate. Everybody knows that.
Lots of cushion there.
Yeah, yeah. And that is why he survived. Mm-hmm. We just worked it out.
There you go. And on that note, do we have anything else? We're at over an hour, so we can...
I just had one note on that episode that I'll always point these out. I'm going to be annoying about it, and it's fine. But, being the girl on the show, I just really loved this moment of these four grown big men listening to a little, 14-year-old girl and probably a little bit older, teenage girl, tell them what to do. And they just sit there and they're like, okay. And I love that's not even, there's no question that these dudes are like, yep, these are two smart, bright young ladies and I'm going to listen to them. And it just warms my heart a little bit that they can exist in a world where they are taken seriously by anyone. Because that doesn't happen to teenage and young girls a lot. So I will always point those moments out because I think they're interesting and important. And we need to find them wherever we can. So that was a small highlight of the episode for me, but a highlight.
Well, and I was going to build off that. I think the overall Omega and Hera teaming up at the end, taking over the transport and flying around, that was wonderful and so enjoyable. And
so cool.
I am really, 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 really hoping that if, we have the Ahsoka show coming up, I'm really hoping that Hera pops up and an older Hera pops up and somehow so does an older Omega and they reunite and they fly starships together and they have the most fun and Omega helps raise, what's his name? Jason?
Jason.
Jason. And I just hope they just live happily ever after. And if anything bad happens to Omega, I will lose my gosh darn mind.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. If Omega gets hurt, I'm gonna hurt someone. I'm gonna get, and probably myself before anybody else, but I'm gonna get very upset. I'm gonna get very angry.
I did really appreciate the when they stole the ship and they're blowing things up, and then you had the Bad Batch's ship, and I think Tech made the comment of, "I think your erratic flying is as confusing them as much as it is confusing us."
Yes, right. There are some great lines in that episode. That's one of them. One a little bit different that I just decided to write down because I was like, Omega's effect on Hunter is my favorite. She just says to this dude, she's trying to save her family, Hunter. I'd do the same for you. And Hunter's questioning his whole life after she says that to him. It's like, yeah, yes, good. Everyone go home because she's got the lines. Some really good jokes in this one. It was just really enjoyable, and it's a shame that it comes off the back of such a, unless you're into the fan service part, which absolutely have fun with that, love that anyone loves it, but a pretty objectively weak episode, removing yourself from that. So I mean if these were one episode that was maybe a little bit longer, if you shorten the first one a little bit and tack it onto this, I think I would have been pleased with it. But yeah, it's a very, very strong episode.
Yeah, I greatly enjoyed it. And it's like that previous, the first part of that two-part thing had everyone I talked to online absolutely loved it.
Great.
And I'm glad that they loved it. It wasn't for me. I'm here for the Bad Batch. That's the name of the show. And it wasn't a Bad Batch. And like I said, I love Rebels with all my heart. And that's not what I wanted here.
Yeah, and I think this is something I'll probably say always, going forward. It's if I don't like something and you do, I'm thrilled for you. I'm thrilled that you enjoyed a thing. You know what I mean? Like, just never take that as too scathing criticism. You know what I mean?
All right. And I think that is it. We'll call this an episode. Thank you, Connor, for tapping in this week when our lovely host had other things that he needed to be doing.
Yes,
he had life stuff.
Thank you for letting me come on and be an agent of chaos and express my opinions. Didn't bring up pod racing once, so, you know,
well,
there's that.
Well,
there it is.
I know. It's almost like I planned it.
Yeah.
but no, it's good to be back. You guys were very gracious about my sudden departure. And the little tribute you guys did the episode after I left was very touching. I've enjoyed the show moving forward. I think Nicole is, I'll say, a better addition than I was.
Well, thank you, sir.
I didn't want to say
high praise.
And also, I don't know if any of the listeners have noticed, the new logo makes me laugh every time.
It's very funny
that Connor is still on the logo. I retooled the logo to add Nicole onto it. JJ had sent me a message going, "You need to add Nicole the logo." I'm like, "Yes, I know. It's on my list of things to do." I did just move into a house, so I have other things. But I didn't want to get rid of Connor altogether, so he's still on there if you look close enough.
Yeah, it's beautiful. But yes, I really appreciate getting the invite to come back on whenever you guys need a sub host and Nick isn't available, or Holly Fry, or Jason Fry, or, you know, any of our other friends. If you run down the list and I'm all that's left, then I will do it.
Holly has never told me no, so I don't know. I don't want to keep pushing that button, but
what a great person.
Yeah, she's lovely. But anyway, yes, thank you. I appreciate it.
All right. If you want to get a hold of us, you can on Twitter. Follow us on our Twitter at Talkin Tauntauns. You could interact with us there. You can DM us if you want to. You can send us an email, talkintauntauns@aiptcomics.com. And we would love to hear your messages, your comments. Tell me why I'm wrong. Tell me why I'm right. I'd prefer you to tell me why I'm right, because I have very low self-esteem. But regardless, I like to hear from you. We like messages. So please get a hold of us. And I think that is it. So until next week, have fun. I don't know how to close this.
That's good enough for me. That works.
Stay safe and have fun, huh?
Thank you.
Be kind.